It's been over a month since the parliamentary impeachment vote. How are things shaping up at the Constitutional Court and in the political realm? Trouble is brewing on the diplomatic front. The issue of sexual slavery once again sparks tensions between Seoul and Tokyo, while Korea's THAAD deployment continues to strain ties with Beijing. All this right ahead. Welcome to News Inside. I'm An Jianghyun. Let's welcome back our panelists. Professor Shin Sang-yeop from Kyung-hee University Graduate School of International Studies joins us once again. And Dr. Bong Young-sik from Yonsei University Institute for North Korean Studies is back as well. It's been over a month since Korea's National Assembly voted to impeach President Park Geun-hye. The impeachment trial is underway while the president remains suspended of her powers. Here's a quick recap of where things stand.
It has been just about a month since Korea's Constitutional Court was tasked with the impeachment trial of President Park Geun-hye.
헌법재판소는 이 사건을 대공 지정의 자세로
It has emphasized speed and fairness in the proceedings so far. There was significant public attention seen at the first impeachment hearing of a president in 12 years.
국민적인 관심사이기 때문에 헌법재판소의 진행 과정을 좀 보러 왔습니다.
얘가 직접 가서 줄을 서면은 할 수 있다 그래서 지금 2시간 기다려서 지금 들어가게 됐습니다.
From the second hearing, witnesses took the stand to be questioned on allegations of power abuse and the relationship between President Park and Choi Soon-sil. During the third hearing, President Park's defense team and lawmakers on the impeachment panel each submitted documents related to the Sewol-ho ferry disaster. The court had stated it would hold one or two hearings each week until February. During the remaining hearings, heated discussions on five main points underlined in the impeachment motion are likely to take place. With the date and outcome of the final ruling unknown, all eyes will remain on each development surfacing from the Constitutional Court.
There's no telling when this will all come to an end, but what are your thoughts as you look back on the past month?
Well, I think still is everything is confusing because over the last 1 month, well, the President Park Geun-hye, through her lawyers, she changed her stance. She insists that she's not guilty enough to be impeached. And then, as you know very well, the special prosecutors are the investigating this case, and the Constitutional Court is reviewing this case as well. So we have to wait and see, but still, well, everything seems to be very confusing.
Mm-hmm. Dr. Bong, what do you think?
I'd like to see that in positive light. For the past month, everything has been progressing within the boundaries of the rule of the law, which is a basic foundation of any functioning democracy. So I think this is a very positive period for South Korean public and politics because the legal systems are working and the people put trust in a legal system as the basic solution to the problems.
Mm-hmm. In the meantime, what kind of impact do you think this whole situation has had on the lives of people in general?
It has, and it will continue to make a great, enormous impact on the every nook and cranny of individual and collective life in the Korean society. And there are some negative impacts and positive impacts. One negative impact I see is a rise of cynicism and political satire among South Korean public. There's numerous satires making humor on the president's defense for herself. I'm terribly heartbroken and remorseful for becoming the president. Mm. And many people cite this president's remark saying that I'm terribly heartbroken and remorseful for, say, being part of the News Insight program, Arirang TV, whenever things are not going well. And what the heck I'm doing here as a president? I don't belong here. That line has been also picked up by many comedians to express the cynicism about the society. Mm-hmm. But on positive side, I am personally quite encouraged by young constituents, students coming back to politics. They used to be indifferent to politics as if they have nothing to do with politics, but their well-being, their future career and personal success cannot be complete without participation in politics, the exercise of their inherent right as participatory citizens in democracy. And the final point on the positive side is that a South Korean public has gained a stronger sense of humility, that there is a widespread admission that we thought we are great, but we are not there yet. That does not necessarily mean that we have failed, but that only means that we have achieved a lot, but enough to be relaxed. There are still many homeworks for us to do in order to complete our long journey to become strong economy, proud democracy, and a country exercising basic human rights.
I don't know if the rise of political satire and cynicism is all that negative. Mm-hmm. Sometimes, you know, it helps to make light of the situation
that we're in. Right, and at the same time, it's a reflection of the better exercise of freedom of speech, right? More relaxed political environment that would allow people to speak their minds without having to worry about any backlash.
Indeed. Well, President Park has become more vocal in defending herself in both the impeachment trial and in the special prosecutor's investigation. Her focus seems concentrated on reversing public opinion that's heavily in favor of her exit from office.
I think we have to categorize the period, the stages of this scandal. The first stage was completed by the impeachment decision. I mean, December 9th. After that, the situations enter into the second stage. Second stage is a kind of some stages which require the additional the explanations on the stance of each side. So I think the at this stage it's quite natural that Park Geun-hye just tried to defend her stance. But it's quite a surprise, I mean, some embarrassing even for us, because when he listened, heard about her explanation about what she did for the 7 hours after the Seoul was sunken down. She also explained her opinion that she just played the role of president during the last 2 years. So totally different explanation from what he expected to hear.
I think her decision to have a New Year's meeting with the reporters was kind of a backfire, because of the way that she tried to defend herself, including the missing 7 hours on the day of the ferry sinking incident, was far from satisfying the public's curiosity. So it somehow did not really help her cause.
I think that plays a bigger part here, public disappointment in what she had to say. Well, Prime Minister Hwang Kyo-an has been acting president for the past month. How do you think he's done so far?
I recall the dictum that silence is golden and no news is a good news. So we just saw the rundown of events for the past month, and the fact that we have spent a month without big surprise, I think that should be contributed to adroit and effective management by acting president, Prime Minister Hwang Kyo-an, despite some minor controversies. So silence is good in times of, you know, national crisis.
Well, there's been a lot of movements in the political arena as well. The ruling party has split, and there's already a heavy focus on the upcoming presidential election. But aren't there other issues that require our more immediate attention?
Yes, there are many issues. So I'm really concerned about maybe this kind of situations will continue for a while. But when you look at the situations facing us, internally and externally, I think I'm really concerned. Well, as you know very well, externally, Chinese government, the expanding their trade sanctions against us, particularly after the
said
deployment decision made by the Korean government. And then the Japanese government also gave high pressures on the Korean the government after the installation of the statue symbolizing the comfort woman in the nearby the Japanese consulate in Busan. So definitely everything is changing very rapidly, but because of the vacuum of the leadership in Korea, we do not do anything in some sense. So I think it's really, it makes many people have some concern about us and about the Korea. I mean, in the, such a kind of situation, as we discussed before, the political leaders and political parties seem to put the first priorities on the presidential election. Yeah. It's quite regrettable to hear that.
Well, as Professor Shin just mentioned, one area of great concern at the moment is foreign relations, with both Japan and China upping the pressure on Korea. Here's a look at the latest.
On January 9th, the Japanese ambassador to Korea was recalled to his home country in protest against a statue symbolizing Korean sex slave victims installed in front of the Japanese consulate in Busan. Seoul's foreign ministry responded with prudence.
어려운 문제가 있더라도 양국 정부 간 신뢰 관계를 바탕으로 한일 관계를 지속 발전시켜 나가야 할 것이라는 점을 다시 한번 강조하고자 한다.
With tensions between Korea and Japan on the rise, the agreement reached by the two countries on sexual slavery is again in the spotlight, especially the parts about Japan's 1 billion yen contribution and the resolution of the girl statue issue. Both at the center of controversy are being closely examined.
가능한 대응 방향에 대해 관련 단체와의 협의 등을 통해 적절히 해결되도록 노력한다.
Differing views on the installation of the symbolic statue have prompted stronger calls for a renegotiation of the deal. Trouble with Japan has also spilled over to economic issues, with Tokyo halting discussions on a currency swap deal. But the problem is, this is not the only trouble Korea is facing on the diplomatic front. Seoul's decision to deploy the U.S. missile defense system THAAD still remains a stumbling block in Korea-China relations. Beijing's foreign minister Wang Yi has cited China's opposition to THAAD as a core diplomatic issue for this year.
주권적이고 자위적인 방어 조치로서 정부로서는 안보 사안에 대해서는 원칙을 당당하게 견지해 나간다는 입장에 변함이 없습니다.
While the country faces a major power vacuum within the top leadership, it is also weighed down by souring relations on the diplomatic front. With Japan and China both being close countries in economic affairs and foreign policy, the question is, how will Korea find a breakthrough for these problems?
Let's start with the sex slave statue installation in front of the Japanese consulate in Busan. Why are these statues such a sensitive issue for the Abe administration?
Because with a joint declaration on December 28, 2015, the Japanese government regarded the comfort woman issue had been settled, quote, finally and irreversibly, especially when the Japanese government, from its standpoint, has steadily and faithfully carried out its own part of the promises, including the provision of $8.3 million that is to be used to establish the foundation of healing and reconciliation for the Korean victims. So from the standpoint of the Japanese government, then Japanese government has done its own part in order to materialize the other joint declaration about a year and a half ago. But the South Korean government has reversed its position and departed from the spirit and the letters of the joint declaration, which, according to the Japanese interpretations, South Korean government promised to make genuine and utmost effort in consultation with the related NGO groups about relocation, if not removal, of the comfort woman statue erected in front of the Japanese embassy building in Seoul. But rather than relocating the statue in Seoul, now, there is another statue erected in Busan in front of the General Consulate
But
of
some
Japan.
Might say it's just a statue.
Some might say it's a statue, but the statue carries an extremely important and heavy symbol, weight of symbolism. And that is explains why the Prime Minister Abe was so insistent when both sides were negotiating the content of the joint declaration in December of 2015 that we have to include the relocation of the comfort moment statue as an absolute precondition.
What exactly does it say in the agreement that has led Tokyo to make this right. kind of demand?
I'll just read the excerpt mm-hmm. of the joint declaration explaining South Korean government's promises that together with the government of Japan, that the issue is resolved finally and irreversibly with this amount. And South Korean government will strive to solve this issue, the comfort moment statue issue, in an appropriate manner through taking measures such as consulting with related organizations about possible ways of addressing this issue. So it's a very conditional promises made by the South Korean government, according to South Korean government's own interpretations of the clause. But from the Japanese government's own interpretation, it's a promise to be kept mm-hmm. by the South Korean government. So the question is whether South Korean government, having agreed on this joint declaration by foreign ministers, has made a genuine and utmost effort to persuade the related organizations about the relocation of statue. Mm. And the erection of another statue in Busan seems to prove that South Korean government has not.
Now, this particular statue in Busan was installed using funds collected from the public and mm-hmm. not by the government, but Tokyo still sees it as a breach of trust between the two countries.
Right,
why,
right.
why is that?
Well, it's quite complicated. To answer your question, we have to examine the situations facing the Japanese government. Externally, they had negotiation with the Russia to get the four islands back from the Russia, but they could not make any progress in the negotiation with Mr. Putin. So because of that, the Japanese government, particularly Prime Minister Abe, was criticized by the politicians and the people. And secondly, along with the United States, Japan has been took the initiatives in the establishment of the TPP, but because of the new leader in the United States, well, they face another wave of difficulties in establishment of the TPP. So because of that also, he was also criticized. Mm-hmm. So because of those kind of external situation, Mr. Abe just tried to divert the people's interest from those issues to the sex slave statue mm-hmm. issue. Particularly, we are in the transitional period. There will be a new the government in the United States and the Korea vacuum of the leadership, and Chinese government just tried to push Japan in a corner. That means they are very severely tried to compete with the Japanese government in an effort to take the initiatives in the region. Mm. So those kind of things are not very favorable for them. But on the other side of the situation, they could maximize their national interest under such a kind of given conditions. Well, I'm very sorry, but this issue can be one of the easy targets for them to strengthen their position.
Yeah, and Japan went so far as to recall its ambassador and consul general. Mm-hmm.
But actually, they took the same measures in 2012.
Right.
When then President Mr. Lee Myung-bak visited to Tokto, they recalled their ambassador, and then about 10 days after, they sent back their ambassador to Korea. But I think this is quite not common measures. In the diplomacy, it's not very widely used measures, but certainly this is one of the strongest measures which they can take.
Mm. Well, Prime Minister Shinzo Abe even brought outgoing U.S. Vice President Joe Biden into this, telling him during a phone conversation that it is important for them to uphold this agreement. Why do you think he did that?
Because he understands that the core interest of the United States is not to get involved in historical and territorial issues between South Korea and Japan, two allies of the United States, but somehow help these two allies overcome the obstacles laid by the historical and territorial issues and forge into, you know, future-oriented security partnership.
So did he want Washington to play the role of a mediator?
No, no, it doesn't. He has no intentions to be a mediator. I mean, United States government in the past history repeatedly emphasized that it has no intentions to be an honest broker. It has no status or legal authority to render any judgment on territorial or historical issues between Asian countries. But it confirms its desire for Asian countries to overcome and reconcile their relationships. So it's a tricky business. But the bottom line is that United States wants South Korea and Japan to move on, overcoming the obstacle of history, as emphasized 2 years ago in commemoration of the 50th anniversary of the 1965 diplomatic normalization between South Korea and Japan, and the 70th anniversary of the end of the Pacific War. And the Washington, we all remember, wasted no time when two foreign ministers announced the joint declaration that they will regard that the issue has been settled finally and irreversibly. The Washington immediately announced the welcoming message. So this incident can be used by Japan as a concrete signal, evidence that Japan is not accountable for the deterioration of the relationship. But it has been South Korean government that has made a promise that it knew it could not keep in good faith. And it is South Korean government that continuously moving the goalpost. So there's no way of making South Korean government and public satisfied with whatever Japan's do in terms of apologizing for the past. Mm-hmm. And the credibility of the South Korean government has been questioned and damaged in international arena.
Some have been saying ever since Korea and Japan reached this landmark agreement on wartime sexual slavery in December 2015, that this agreement should be scrapped altogether, right, or at the very least be renegotiated. Mm-hmm. Is that a feasible option?
Anything is possible, but in that case, then the international credibility of South Korea as a sovereign country will be greatly damaged. Mm. South Korean government has to assume the backlash if it's going to try to scrap the deal with Japan, that South Korean government's image can be seen as a country that cannot really keep the other international agreements. Mm. That was the intention by both governments, to leave the basic character of the joint declaration intentionally vague and ambiguous, subject to different interpretations.
And without consultation?
Without consultation with the victims, mm-hmm, because they just wanted to move on with this joint declaration. Mm. And by lowering the legal status of this agreement as a joint declaration by, not by head of the states, by foreign ministers, they tried to evade the difficult process of the ratification in the Diet or National Assembly. So there's an escape clause available to South Korea, that it was just the expression of the utmost and genuine desire for Ministry of Foreign Affairs of South Korea to try to settle this issue in cooperation with the Japanese government once for all. Finally and irreversibly. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't really represent the official and central position of the South Korean government. But I don't know whether this kind of a justification will be received as legitimate and persuasive to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. Because this issue is very thorny and important to South Koreans and Japanese, but other countries do not really know about inside and outside of the issue. Another issue that we have to keep in mind is that scrapping the deal is not only regarding South Korea and Japan. If South Korea scraps this deal, then how China would perceive this? Then, okay, then South Korea decided to scrap one of the most important and controversial deals with Japan. Then why don't we put another additional pressure on South Korea to scrap their decision to deploy THAAD, right? Mm-hmm. South Korea will be left with no comeback line toward the China.
Well,
that's the point which actually I wanted to underline. I mean, before the agreement was signed by both governments, we had the initiatives in dealing with this issue in the relationship with Japan. Do you remember that Mr. Abe wanted to meet President Park Geun-hye to discuss about these issues?
Right.
But President Park Geun-hye did not meet him. But after the agreement, signed by both governments, actually Japanese government seems to have the initiatives in dealing with these issues. Well, because of those kind of things, we are in a corner. The disagreement maybe seemed the Korea, put the Korea in jeopardy. So I think in this context, I think the government was not very good. In making a decision whether they sign on disagreement or not.
Especially now that the administration that made both the decisions to reach this deal with Japan and to deploy THAAD going through a power vacuum.
Right.
Depending on who becomes the next leader of Korea, anything could happen.
But the leadership change does not necessarily allow a country to scrap deal signed as a sovereign state. Remember that when Soviet Union collapsed, Russia inherited all the international agreements that had been signed by the Soviet Union. That was the mainstream international law in terms of inheritance of the sovereignty. So leadership change in the next presidential election in South Korea does not allow South Korean government to be free from the previous agreements, however controversial they might be, signed by the Park Geun-hye administration, because it is a representation and exercise of a sovereignty of the Republic of Korea, not just the exercise of the authority of a particular regime. So it's a big trouble, and especially the international image of South Korea is in a negative light, because the bottom line is that Japan's government has provided $8.3 million. So it has a very strong case to show to the rest of the world that we have fulfilled, despite all the difficulties, to move on with the agreement. What has South Korean government, done on its part to carry out the joint declaration?
So basically, there's no way out since we received the money.
No, there's a way out. There's a way out, which is to take advantage of current situation, the leadership vacuum to our advantage, South Korea's advantage, meaning that we have all the good intentions to faithfully fulfill the joint declaration with Japan, but our current political conditions would not allow the government, central government, to carry out the agreement in good faith, because this issue is so enormously important that it should be left to be decided not by acting president, who only carry out the authority of the president in interim basis, but the next president of South Korea.
So that just means we're buying time.
We are buying time.
Until
we are
the next time. Leadership comes in.
But the statements that the next president, next government will deal with this issue can be it has some possibility to give a wrong signal to Chinese government.
Right.
That means that, who is the prominent candidate at the moment? Opposition party leaders. And they officially has been against the deployment of THAAD. Right? So it can be misunderstood on the part of Chinese government. Maybe next president will scrap change the decision about deployment of THAAD. Or on the part of Japanese government, maybe they will scrap the disagreement. Those kind of things. The situation at the moment is not very favorable for Korean government and for Korean people in dealing with these two issues. But one thing which I want to underline is that politicians should be extremely careful. If we are divided into, maybe it will be extremely difficult to seek for our national interests.
Well, another step Japan took was halting discussions on a currency swap deal with Korea. Is that something Korea needs to worry about?
Well, at the moment, it's not that much vocal, because we have a huge amount of foreign reserves. But in the future, it can be a very important. Well, in fact, in August last year, South Korean government proposed the reestablishment of a swap deal with Japanese government. And the, I mean, actually, the swap deal with Japan expired in early 2015. And according to the Seoul Economic Daily, maybe it would worth about the $50 billion dollars, more than $50 billion. So it's going to be very, very important for the Korean financial market, finance, Korean economy. Because considering the global economy, financial market stability seems to be very important. But because of the suspending of swap deal negotiation with Japan, maybe it can give some side effects on the swap deal negotiation with China and even United States. Suppose we cannot get the swap deal with those major economies surrounding us, the Korean financial market could be threatened. If financial market is not very safe enough, maybe Korean economy will face another difficulties. As we discussed many times, the Korean economy has heavily relied on external trade. Slowdown, a sluggish global economy has been some barriers or burden on the Korean economy. But in such a kind of difficult situations, the swap deal has been one of the ways we can use to keep the dynamism in our economy. But if we cannot have the swap deal with these major economies, certainly it can be additional burden on the Korean economy.
Let's talk about our relations with China. Seoul has seen a number of measures from Beijing believed to be in retaliation for the THAAD deployment decision. Well, recently, seven Korean opposition lawmakers visited China for talks. Was that a wise move? There seems to be a difference of opinion, depending on who you ask.
My cautious response to your controversial question is it depends. Given the absence of reliable communication line between Beijing and Seoul, any opening of a line of communication with the Chinese government, especially the high-ranked officials in charge of military affairs and foreign relations, should be regarded as a positive development because they could exchange a very candid view on issues of mutual interest. In that regard, that the visit by the opposition party, members at the National Assembly could have fulfilled positive function if there was effective input of Korea's voice and the concern about important issues lying between the countries, including the reason why South Korea would need the deployment of THAAD for national defense. And without THAAD, South Korea is not really with any reliable alternative. I don't know whether China's side was willing to accept that kind of explanation, or the opposition party members actually deliver that kind of explanations to the Chinese side.
Yes.
But under the circumstances in which the Chinese government officials have not really agreed to have official meetings with the Korean ambassador to China, Mr. Kim Jang-soo, for a long period of time, then any opening of a communication channel should be regarded, at least in theory, a positive development.
Well, you do have to wonder what position these lawmakers presented,
right,
seeing that they come from the opposition.
Right. But the downside of this visit is that it might have increased the false hope inside the Chinese government that with a little more nudge or pressure, then the new president of South Korea may actually decide to scrap the whole deal, the deployment of THAAD. So in previous period, before the political turmoil that suspended Park Geun-hye's presidency, the goal of China's pressure diplomacy towards Seoul with regard to the THAAD issue has been mostly criticism and opposition. But these days, it seems like Chinese government has developed a genuine hope that more pressure may result in reversing the decision of the deployment under the new leadership in South Korea. So we are charting into more dangerous territory.
Well, as I said before, we've seen a number of measures, both trade and economic measures, that are believed to be in retaliation for the THAAD deployment decision. What areas have been the hardest hit by these actions from China?
Yes, since the THAAD deployment decision was made in July 2016, well, Chinese government has expanded its trade sanctions, such as the ban the airplanes travel to South Korea, and the restricting broadcasting appearances by the Korean entertainers. And the, very recently, they withhold the imports of the Korean cosmetics. Well, in fact, they banned imports of the cosmetics, I mean, 28 products. Out of 28 products, 19 products were made Korean products. I mean, considering the importance of Chinese market for the cosmetic industries, it's very negative decision. Mm-hmm. Well, out of the total export volume made by the Korean cosmetic industry, 37% exports goes to go to Chinese market. And on the top of this one, in fact, the, very recently there was the meeting between two governments to discuss about the FTAs between two countries. Mm-hmm. So considering the current situations facing us, definitely there was a very hot debate between two governments about the trade sanctions imposed by the Chinese government against Korean producers. So what I'm saying is that definitely there will be more economic sanctions from Chinese government against Korean producers, and the, considering the importance of Chinese market on the Korean economy, well, it seems to be very, very important. So we have to find a way to solve the these current issues. I mean, current situations as soon as possible.
Well, in light of these difficulties, there's been a lot of criticism about Korea's foreign policy. What do you think is the main problem here, and what can be done about it?
Well, I think the lack of the communication among the the political leaders, and even including political parties, and the so we failed. I mean, the Korean government failed to get the support from the people. I mean, in considering the current situation we have, definitely the support from the people seems to be very, very important. But the, in this regard, I mean, Korean government has not performed very well over the last several months.
Dr. Bong, what do you think?
Well, we have to clarify the locus of responsibility for better governance. It seems like the decision to introduce U.S. thought has been made, but nobody seems to claim responsibility. And the joint declaration was made on December 28, 2015, but when things get worse, nobody seems to come out as a to claim responsibility for the decision. Mm-hmm. So you have to, you know, name it to claim it. So we have to first go back to the drawing board, and what kind of foreign policy and what kind of core national interest are we going to pursue under very difficult internal and external circumstances, and what kind of resources we are endowed with to pursue these goals. Mm-hmm. We have to know our potential, but at the same time, limitations, and clarify the locus of responsibility. So when things go well, then credit will be given to where credit is due, and when things are going bad, then we have to see who was responsible and how we are going to address the issues. Mm.
All right, well, we have to wrap up our discussion. Your final thoughts of the week?
Well, I think the to have a very successful sailing, we need three things: good ship, good weather, and good crew members. Mm-hmm. We have a very quite good ship, I mean, named Republic of Korea. We have 11th or 12th largest economy in the world. But the weather is getting worse and worse. So what we can do, that means that we have to build a teamwork among the crew members, but unfortunately, we lost our captain at the moment. So what we can do right now at the moment, that means that we can work together. We have to put the first priority on having a very successful sailings. So at every position where we are, we have to make every effort to do our best.
Yes, and you've been asking the political leaders out there to do their part for the past few weeks,
yes.
Right? Dr. Bong.
I'd like to second Professor Shin saying that true character is tested by adversities, not blessings. And it is true that our country is going through probably one of the toughest challenges in modern history. And if you look back, there is a numerous crisis, but somehow the South Korean country and its people overcame those challenges. Mm. So I hope the history repeats itself.
Yeah, we do have a proven track record.
Right, right.
Well, thank you two very much for sharing your thoughts with us today.
Thank you.
That's all for this edition of News Inside. Thanks for watching. We'll be back with more next week.